Hmm?
Do you ever have deja vu?
Didn't you just ask me that?
Wait, didn't I just use that clip in the last video? Oh no. And we're also hunting for Skulltulas again. Wait, I did this last video. It's all happening over again! And we're in the No. This is the Mississippi King, welcoming y'all back to more Let's Play The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time. In the last episode, we actually did some Skulltula hunting and we got 3 pieces of heart, as well as a couple magic spells, and a bomb bag upgrade, the biggest bomb bag in the game. So welcome back, Mississippi Dukes. And now that we have 30 Skulltulas, we can actually collect a third reward from the House of Skulltula, and this one is actually really good. You'll want to pick this up. And I don't know whether it's necessary to buy any items, but it is still nice to have. So yeah, you get the giant's wallet, and that allows you to carry 500 rupees. And that is really nice. Of course, the wallet size in this game is absolutely nothing compared to, like, the Wind Waker, although that one has a wallet size that is stupidly big for even stupider reasons because of a certain fairy boy who shall not be named. Don't believe him. Don't believe his lies. He's a scammer who loves to drive people bankrupt. If you've played the Wind Waker, you know exactly what I'm talking about. But in this episode, we're actually going to enter the Temple of Time and see what we can do to stop Ganondorf. Perhaps we can even get some more items later on in the video. But what happens is that, like, you should wait. If you wait till night for the bridge to shut and you, like, let it carry you up to the top, you can actually pick up some red rupees, I should say. They're worth 20. They're not 20 rupees. Well, I mean they are, but they're not called a 20 rupee. Like, no one says, I got a $20. Like, that don't make sense. Speaking of money, pay attention to the market. See how it'll change shortly. Also, I don't think this part will be particularly, like, I don't think it'll lend itself very well to jokes. But what's coming up is one of the most epic cutscenes in the game, and I know I keep using that word a lot, but yeah, I mean, that's just the word that I think that best describes this game. Epic. It's like a modern version of the hero's journey or something like that. What you want to do is stand in front of that altar and play the Song of Time, which will allow you to use all 3 spiritual stones to open the way forward. That's how you proceed. Also, it should be ye who owns these 3 spiritual stones, because, like, the use of ye is actually correct, since it's referring to both Link and Navi, since it's plural. Then the Triforce symbol will light up. The door opens. What do you reckon inside? If you go inside, you'll find something that should look familiar to anyone who's played A Link to the Past, or like, almost any Zelda game. Not everyone, though. It's not universal throughout the series. There are some games that actually lack this. But yeah, it's the Master Sword. And if you take the Master Sword, it will transport you. What happens when we get teleported? Well, I'll let Ganondorf explain.
Excellent work. As I thought, you hold the keys to the door of time. You have led me to the gates of the sacred realm. Yes, I owe it all to you, kid.
So yeah, we actually caused Ganondorf to win. But there's something else, too. We find ourselves in the sacred realm, as you may expect. And there's an old man right there. So that's interesting. Our heroism actually led to Ganondorf's victory. The rest of the game is about taking him down. There's the old man.
I am Raru, one of the ancient sages. Ages ago, we ancient sages built the Temple of Time to protect the entrance to the sacred realm. This is the Chamber of Sages, inside the Temple of Light. The Temple of Light, situated in the very center of the Sacred Realm, is the last stronghold against Ganondorf's evil forces. A Master Sword, the evil-destroying sword that you pulled out of the pedestal of time, was the final key to the Sacred Realm. Emching, don't be alarmed. Look at yourself.
We're an adult. We've traveled in time. Yep. 88 miles per hour! I mean, I had to make that reference.
The Master Sword is a sacred blade which evil ones may never touch. Only one worthy of the title of Hero of Time can pull it from the pedestal of time. However, you are too young to be the Hero of Time. Therefore, your spirit was sealed here for 7 years. And now that you are old enough, the time has come for you to awaken as the Hero of Time. Well, do you understand your destiny?
Yes.
But remember, though you opened the door of time in the name of peace, Ganondorf, the Gerudo King of Thieves, used it to enter this forbidden sacred realm. He obtained the Triforce from the Temple of Time, and with its power he became the King of Evil. The evil power radiated from the temples of Hyrule, and in 7 short years, he transformed it into a world of monsters. My power now has only little influence, even in this sacred realm. Namely, this Chamber of Sages. But there is still hope. The power of the sages remains. When the power of all the sages is awakened, the sages' seals will contain the evil power of this world into the realm. I, Raru, am one of the sages, and your power to fight together with the sages makes you the Hero of Time. The Hero of Time chosen by the Master Sword. keep my spirit with you. Find the power of the other sages and add their might to your own.
With that, we have finally collected our first medallion. And that is one of the things that the series, well, that this game will deal with. What a person has to deal with when growing older. And gaining a new perspective. It deals with the cynicism of adulthood, juxtaposed with the innocence and naivety of childhood. Also, I mean, I am doing so much of these videos lately that, like, I have legitimately been having nightmares about this whole Let's Play thing, where it's like I'll dream, like, my microphone just broke, or that my capture card failed me, or something else like that. I mean, I think I need some help here. This ain't cool. I mean, this is just plain weird. But yeah, this cutscene is incredibly epic. And it also introduces us to a theme that we will be hearing later on in the game as well. And it is one of the game's more emotional themes. Koji Kondo is a musical genius. Like, Koji Kondo, I'll just say it right here, he is the John Williams of video game composers. His work is iconic. I mean, who hasn't heard at least one of his pieces? And his work is also incredible, and he knows how to use music to evoke emotions. I mean, like, say what you will about the Star Wars prequels, but the John Williams music in them was, like, one of the only good things in it. Like, his music was the only thing good about the Star Wars prequels. Pretty much everything else about them sucked. I think that's one thing you can say about the Zelda games all the time, is that they know how to use music to evoke emotion. Like, it's more so than, say, like, the Mario games. Now, don't get me wrong, I enjoy the Mario games as much as the next guy. But for me, when it comes to Nintendo, I've always been a Zelda guy. And as you can see, the marketplace is devastated. Hyrule is in shambles. So, I don't know of any other Zelda game besides maybe Link to the Past where Ganondorf actually wins. In a sense. But yeah, what you want to do is to stop him. Now Hyrule's been left in ruins. Most people have just moved it to Kakariko Village. Which is where we want to go, by the way, as Sheik had just told us. There's an important item there. Also, about the nightmares I keep having about the Let's Play, I really think that something weird about that is going on. Like, they keep haunting my nightmares so much. I mean, who keeps giving me these nightmares? The Sonic and this. Oh, wait, did I just say that? I didn't mean it. Of course, like, your original character, Ashiro the Badger, is the most original thing ever conceived by a human, and totally not
another reskin. Of course, people put a lot of effort into these original characters. Do not steal them. Well, anyway, you want to head to the Kakariko graveyard. Bring out your dead. Make no mistake, the Sonic fanbase will haunt the nightmares of the faint of heart. I mean, I'm not sure if that's happened to me, but I think it has. Because, like, just how much more infamous can you get than the Sonic fanbase? Anyway, there are some Poes here. You can kill them. And I'm trying to look for that grave that you need to open. Where is it? I think maybe it's around here somewhere. If you go inside one of them, then, well, this is what you'll find. And you'll meet all the ghosts of Dompei. And you want to race him. You'll actually be coming back here later for a piece of heart. But right now you want to come here to get an item. In other news, the dead walked the earth! Yep, he's undead. I don't think they ever say it, but yeah, he has a halo over his head. He's found in a grave, yet he died somehow. What killed him? I don't know. Ask the game designers. They don't ever say it. This race can be really tricky, and you've got to be pretty quick. So, and he's kind of a cheating. He can float like it. You can't. But anyway, that's all for the race. We did fairly well. We will be coming back here, but not for a while. I mean, we could do it, like, as soon as we get out of here, I guess, but I just don't really feel like doing that. He'll give us an item now that we've bested him in the race. This item is what we'll need to progress to the next dungeon, which, by the way, I am not going to be doing in this video, okay? That's for either the next one or the one after that. Still haven't quite decided, but I'm leaning more towards getting it out of the way sooner. And you'll see why when I actually get to that door. When I finish the next dungeon, that is. I really dig this place. It must have been quite the undertaking to have made. Personally, I'm not undead, but I have been coughing a lot. No one's laughing. No one finds that funny. Man, y'all are such a grave crowd. Okay. I mean, I'm buried in work, and this is the response I get. Okay. In all seriousness, that place back there, now that I think about it, it kind of reminds me of Chrono Cross, the Isle of the Damned. I don't know. Am I weird for thinking that? I don't know, something about the lighting and the atmosphere sort of resembles the Isle of the Damned in Chrono Cross, or rather, I guess I should say, the Isle of the Damned reminds me of that place in Ocarina of Time. I mean, I have played Ocarina of Time before Chrono Cross, so. But nevertheless, they do kind of remind me of each other. But anyway, this guy teaches you the Song of Storms, which is going to come in handy. And it's actually a really neat song. Personally, it's one of my favorites in Ocarina of Time. Once you play it, it speeds up the water, the windmill. So, that's probably not, that's not something he does. Also, this guy is like the result of like, it leads to a huge time paradox that we'll deal with later when we come to it. But it doesn't make a lick of sense. It's a complete paradox. But anyway, that's all for this episode. This is the Mississippi King signing out. And in the next episode, we may actually tackle the first dungeon as Adult Link. See y'all next time.